my mother was entering an advanced stage of Alzheimer's. And I knew that if I didn't spend a substantial amount of time with her at this point, it won't be the same, and she would have probably forgotten me, and she won't register our being together anymore.
Well, a few months ago, we started the Human Beast series. We wouldn't have thought that the conversation with René Hirschhorn about death rituals is going to be important and relevant for one of the group members. But sadly, this is what exactly happened when Nusrat Durrani, my friend and collaborator on this project, lost his mother a few weeks ago. Nusrat is a very brave and visionary filmmaker and producer who graciously agreed that we would record our conversation between two friends, and turn it into a Human Beast episode.
I thought maybe what we could do is that we could talk a little bit about your mum. How did this film come about? The stories I told my mother.
I've been spending the last 2 or 3 years of my life on a sabbatical. A very substantial amount of that time I spent with her in India, in Lucknow, where she lives, being close, spending hours every day with her, holding her hand, taking her from the bedroom to the garden, and really engaging with her. But, her mind was like really not there, and it was like a bulb that was about to go off. And I felt like whenever I spoke to her about the past, or I tried to evoke in her images of things that have happened or people that she might have known, or just told simple stories to her about my day or about my life, that she would really momentarily awaken, and she would respond.
The power of telling a story, of her son telling a story, generated light.
Yes, it brought about spurts of light, bursts of light that,
And it worked.
It worked for a long while. I mean, at least for a year or 1.5 years when her mind was still somewhat, healthy, it worked. If I said to her, do you remember father, and that was his garden. Remember how he used to come out and sit here where you're sitting and look at the birds and make a little video? Then she would respond to that. While I was spending a lot of time with my mother, I was also traveling the rest of the world. I was coming across these incredible stories of people I met. The stories that I remembered most and that resonated most for me were all had women at the heart of them. At the center were women, strong women. Whenever I returned home to my mom, if there was a story that I remembered, I would tell her that story. In Lebanon, I volunteered in a Syrian refugee camp, and I met a lot of people who had undergone incredible hardship. And yet they were hopeful and joyous and optimistic and not bitter or cynical. And many of them were young girls who were in the charge of their grandparents, or somebody else's mother was taking care of an orphan girl. Women were holding up that experience. When I told my mother this story, it was in the context of how many young girls and how many young women she had helped in a nursing home. Her life's work was all about this, empowering people and helping poor people. I told her the story of these little girls who were so vivacious and courageous. And I used to tell her, remember, you used to be like this, And sometimes you'd be like, oh, what were those girls like? What did they wear? who was feeding them? Who was feeding them, you know? Or I used to tell them how I helped raise funding for emergency surgeries for some of these refugees. And she would be like, oh, they don't have a doctor there, you know? You should bring them to our clinic. So it kept her so engaged every time I told her a story that was somehow resonated in courage and compassion, that she would spark, sometimes just come alive, you know?
It's so interesting because we are driven by stories. I mean, we are the only species, as far as we can tell, that tells stories, that has a complex enough language so that we can tell stories. And we tell stories all the time. And very often, our memories are really stories. I mean, you know, we dream stories. We daydream stories often. And what you describe here is that you were, the way I hear it, is that you found particular memory hooks in her brain. In her brain that was disintegrating in many ways. But there were still these hooks, and you were able to put a pointer onto a hook and then tell her a story that with which maybe she relived a piece of her own memory, but also you were able to share your life with her, your stories with her.
It was very gratifying in the moment, for sure, because anything that could spark my mother's imagination and bring her back to me, even momentarily, was a beautiful, amazing thing. Because it's very sad to see a parent disappear into the mist of Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. At a distance, it was a little bit different because there was so much sadness also wrapped around the fact that she was disappearing. To me, all of the really incredible narratives around courageous women that I had been sharing with my mother were at the forefront of my mind. So I just did what I know how to do is, you know, string together a series of very short anecdotal stories about courageous women that I had told my mother. And I made a film. The film version of that is called Stories I Told My Mother. It's 1969, Lucknow, India. Rabia, a woman in her 30s wearing a sari, is smoking a hand-rolled cigarette filled with Prince Henry tobacco. Her wavy black hair is astray in the wind as she distributes wages to the dozen rickshaw pullers who are her first entrepreneurial venture. Early next morning, she's driving her three children and two of the neighbor's kids to school in her green Fiat. The only woman in a parking lot full of men. At night, she will return to the small pharmacy she's invested in and work until closing time at 11 p.m. Those are images of my mother, the unlikely dissident who taught me everything I know about courage. Dutiful wife, savior of the sick, daughter of a patriarchy who broke all the rules and rewrote her narrative. Mother was stubborn, with a superhuman ability to handle failure. She nonchalantly defied the odds and earned a medical degree late in her 50s after she founded the first private nursing home in the city. I was really quite moved by the response to the film. Because there was such an emotional response to it.
By now, I've seen many times.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm very deeply touched by it. Do you think that our friendship, your and my friendship, has something to do with our admiration of strong women? That there's something about female strength as opposed to male strength that is empowering those who are witnessing it and on whom this around whom this strength is projected. But funny enough, I don't think we've ever talked about this. So I've written a book, yeah, that, and you made this movie, and yeah, so I wonder whether, I don't know, I mean, so, yeah, I think you and I have a connection, I mean, obviously, but we have a connection that is, that is, that has this additional element, additional link.
I think it's a fascinating intersection between us, for sure. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. I think that both of us have been shaped by strong women. And I think a lot of men are shaped either by the presence of amazing, beautiful, strong women or by their absence. I have been shaped by their presence. My mother was a very important influence in my life. And you in your study and in you in your relationships and friendships have, I think, had a similar enlightening experience around women. And your book resonates with that. So absolutely, I think that our connection has a lot to do with our relationship with women, for sure.
Yeah, and you know, I've done some work on friendship between men and women, and the weird thing is that I think your and my friendship is much more similar to the typical female friendship, women with women friendship, than male to male friendship. It's very weird. I'm going to think about this.
Is it very weird? Because I mean, we all have a feminine side, I believe. As we have a masculine side, you know, as well. We're jammed with experiences and stories and, you know, and love and hate and emotions. If you look at my work, you know, whatever work I've done in media, a lot of that work is driven by women or inspired by women or feature women in very prominent ways. Of course, Stories I Told My Mother is a short documentary thing, which, you know, it's not even a professional piece of content. But if you see my film Madly, which is an anthology of short films about love, you know, two of those films have been directed by women, and they're, in my mind, the strongest films. The one, the short that won Best Actress at Tribeca for Radhika Apte has a strong female character at the heart of it. But all of my work, including Rebel Music, the series, also has either the best episodes have been created by women at the heart of it, at the heart of the production, or feature strong female characters. Because there is such a collapse of male leadership in the world, politically, in the corporate world as well, that I feel like we need to bring more women at the forefront of change. To change the global narrative, we need to have more storytelling from women. Women process things very different. You know, the articulation of female rage is such an interesting thing, I think, because we prefer women to respond to things with sadness. That's a much more acceptable role, I think, for women to take, is they respond to tragedy or oppression through sadness. And we try to make that sadness look very beautiful. It's a very convenient way for the rest of the world to respond. But AOC, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, she delivered a talk in front of Congress the other day. And the way she harnessed rage, anger, the way she harnessed it and transformed it into something curative and powerful was incredible. And I think that, and I'm not suggesting that female rage should always be articulated in a positive, harnessed way. I mean, women are angry sometimes, and they're messy, and they're chaotic like men are too. But I just think that the way that women artists, for example, respond to the world and its crisis, this current crisis, is quite different. And I think we need that nuance, we need that sensitivity, we need that strangeness, the newness of women shaping our narrative.
I presume you showed the film to your mom. Did you watch it together? Did you view it together?
We watched the parts of it together. We watched the opening because it has her in it.
Yeah.
And I think she recognized herself, you know, in the film. And then we watched some elements because it was very hard for me to sustain her attention to something for 21 minutes.
Which of these women that you portrayed in the film is she most for you?
That's such a difficult question to answer because I think she is in so many of those women. She is the woman, the French philosopher, whose life's work is about taking risks. And when that woman saw these children drowning, she just jumped into the ocean and saved them and gave up her own life. That woman is obviously worlds apart from my mother, but she's so similar. There's a story of women firefighters of California, these prisoners who, for very small amounts of money, are going and saving other people's property and life by fighting fires and sometimes sacrificing their own lives. The film about Syrian refugees, I also saw her as those children who were so resilient despite the hardships. The story of the girl, Lakshmi Agarwal, who had acid thrown on her face and despite everything became a spokesperson for women. My mother was like that too. I mean, India and other countries like it are dominated by men. And when my mother was trying to find herself in the 60s and the 70s, there were not a lot of role models of women entrepreneurs or women doing amazing stuff. And she was operating in a world of men. And she navigated that very courageously and became who she was. And she didn't become some billionaire or some famous person, but in her own way, in her own life, she impacted thousands of lives of sometimes very poor people against all odds. That was the thing, you know? And so in short, I think my mother might have been all of those women too.
Alzheimer's, it's a very difficult thing to process because your mind that would be doing the processing that you have a gradual fogginess is the one that's getting foggy. So it's a tricky thing to have any kind of meta thought. But because you are bringing in these stories with their hooks, with that were directly referencing her own life, her own memories, I presume some of these stories, the deaths within these stories, would trigger a self-referential thought.
When my mother saw the film, I think she was beyond the stage of making a connection with her own impending exit from the world. But there's a very interesting incident that occurred between me and her a few years ago when she was still present. We visited my father's grave together. And, you know, my mother was devoted to my father as she was devoted to all of us. And she probably had forgotten that he had died. And one of the things about Alzheimer's that is so very tragic and painful is that sometimes you forget somebody close to you has died and then you remember they have died and you sorrow. And sometimes this becomes a repetitive thing that you forget and then remember again and again, and you have to go through the grieving of somebody's death repetitively. And I think that she saw my father's grave and suddenly it occurred to her that he had died. Mm-hmm. And it just triggered something in her. And she was extremely disturbed for a few days after that, trying to grapple with the fact that he's dead. And although he'd passed away 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. It was incredibly disturbing to me because at that time I realized this particular thing that, you know, people who have Alzheimer's sometimes forget that they've lost something and that loss recurs again and again and again in a very jittery and very very disturbing manner. And so you have to be careful with how you reveal that type of information. Her only brother died when she was in an advanced stage of Alzheimer's. And instead of hiding that fact from her, we let her participate in the rituals of grieving. And I think that we did the right thing because, you know, she managed that grief differently from how she might have done it if we didn't even tell her that he had died.
The ritual of the grieving worked almost like a story that was provided a way of registering a new memory, which takes us to how rituals around death are being impacted. These rituals now are disappearing from our life, and with the COVID crisis, when people die alone, and then for epidemiological reasons, their bodies are discarded. We are short of these rituals, and hence almost like we can't register the memory. Yeah.
That episode is so important and so relevant to today. Those who have seen it have responded so emotionally to it because we are all touched by loss these days, you know, whether it's a relative or a parent or a friend, there is so much loss that actually the rituals of grieving and letting go and dealing with that kind of loss are paramount, I believe. Mm-hmm. And yet you're cut off from that. And when we made the episode and we were sharing it with others, to me, it was a very important subject, but still it was a little bit distant, you know, in that I had been caring for my mother and I had been separated from her since March, which is about 4 months ago, but I hadn't lost her. But then suddenly she was gone. And everything we discussed in that episode came true in a very immediate and urgent and raw manner for me because she was gone. She died 8,000 miles away. And there was nothing I could do, first of all, in caring for her in the end, you know, when she was in intensive care and asking for me. She asked for me. She said, tell my son to come and take me away. And I wasn't there, you know. So there's that. And I wasn't there because of pandemic. But then when she was gone, I couldn't participate in any of the rituals of letting go, and that would be to share the grief with other people, to actually physically participate in her funeral or any of that. I simply couldn't be there. And as far as I'm concerned, except for the phone calls and Zoom calls and WhatsApp calls, it could have been just another day in New York City. That theory of that we were, the theories we were talking about in that episode came true for me. And it was, there's no way for me to articulate what that's like when you lose a parent and you lose them remotely and you grieve remotely and you are grasping for anything at all to transform that mad sorrow you feel into something more tolerable. And I had to attend my mother's funeral on WhatsApp. I had to see, and it felt like there was such brutal poetry to that I even wonder if I should have participated in that way at all, or I should have just let it happen in my imagination. Because it felt to me that a whole lot of strangers, she was beloved, so there were a lot of people despite the pandemic who actually attended her funeral. And I just felt like, who are all these people taking away my mother, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was savage. It was brutal, all of the things that I felt then. But you know, there was no choice. I mean, there wasn't a plane I could get onto. There was no way for me to participate other than through Zoom or WhatsApp. And I don't wish this upon anybody, but the fact is we will need to find ways to to replace those rituals that existed in the physical world into something more appropriate to now. And
when you participated in the WhatsApp call, was there a ritual that was offered for everybody to participate in?
It was essentially what a lot of people are doing. There was a family Zoom call and around the funeral. I don't honestly know if anything can ever replace the touch and presence and warmth and voice and being there. So yeah, we participated in rituals, but they're not satisfying to me. It's all we have.
So I designed one for you. And
I was sure that you would do something like that.
And so I will tell you, and if you rather not, I will, you know, our friendship will be completely untouched, obviously. And I will now give it to you on this call, this recorded call, but I think we should afterwards this sleep on it. You should particularly sleep on it, and we should then decide whether we. I wanted to give it to you in our first conversation about this.
Okay.
And I'm not sure if it works. When you have a ritual, the rituals that are projected onto a screen for you are not really rituals. They are movies. Yeah. The real ritual, behaviorally relevant ritual, is when you do something yourself with your body. That triggers the behavior that is the ritual behavior. And it's important that it's a sequence that is repeated. It's a 32-day ritual.
Oh, okay.
Because, you know, René taught us that a ritual takes time.
Sure.
And so what you could do, if you like, is that you could create a space somewhere at home and put there a paper box. And then take a piece of paper and listen to the aria, the first, you know, the main aria before the variations come in of the Goldberg variations. So you listen to that. And then on the piece of paper, write down 10 numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10. And next to it, have three little boxes, each number. Next to each box, have three boxes. And I suggest that you divide your mom's life into 10 phases.
Hmm.
And for each phase, choose something sad that happened in that phase, something happy that happened in that phase, and something empowering that happened, or transformational that happened in that phase. And ideally, it would be chronological, so from younger to older. And what you could do maybe is that the first day, then you listen to the aria, you make this list. And next day, listen to the first variation and create something with your hands that is the representation of that first box. Yeah, so number one, box one. And it's very important that you create it with your hand. It can be a drawing. If it's a photograph, then you could copy the photograph, a sculpture, but take time and make sure that little object at the end represents that sadness of that phase in your mom's life. And when you're done, maybe listen to again for the first variation, but this time together with the aria. So the aria, first variation, and put this little object, a drawing, a sculpture, whatever, into that box. And next day, move on to the number one, box two, happy. So think of a happy, something that happened that was happy for your mom in that phase. Create again an object with your hand and put that object while listening to the second variation into the box. And then listen to the aria, first variation and second variation. And as you go ahead, you're going to really know the melody in each of these. So if you can hum it while you're listening, participate in this, and then put that object into the box. And if you have time and energy for this, because I presume it would be quite difficult, go through the 30 variations. Every time making an object while listening to the next variation. And then when you put it in, listen from the very beginning all the way to that, but only to that variation.
Got it.
And when you get to the 32nd day, which is the repeat of the aria, on that day, you don't have any objects left, but you have a box full of these memories and all of them you created. Then listen to the whole thing again. By now, hum the whole thing. And then if you have the power, burn the box.
Sorry, what? In the end, if you have the power?
Burn the box.
Okay.
Collect those ashes into something and put those little ashes of memories, of burnt memories. And if you next time visit your mom's, you go to India, maybe take it with you.
It's fascinating. Sure, I will try that. It sounds like a very therapeutic, but also very spiritual exercise. And I think, yeah, I will try that.
If you try it, I think the most important thing is that you participate in the music. It's really physical. It's, you do it. Yeah. It's not even on the screen. You do it manually. You have use your body in it. And ideally the same sequence every time. I mean, even I feel this, you know, the weight of this. So I'm not sure, even telling you, I presume for you, even the thought of this might be quite tough.
But it's tough and involved and complex, but grieving is tough and involved and complicated. Sadness is all of those things too. And you cannot expect to get over whatever you're feeling with a simple quick fix solution, you know? So I think that the ritual you're proposing is definitely sounds medicinal, you know, something that I would have gone through differently if I was with her and I was in the city where she died. I would have had to do a lot of these types of things, you know, with her objects, her jewelry, her clothing, or whatever it was. And those are also difficult things to do, you know, for somebody who's just died that you love. And this is complex in a different way. So I think that I'm not afraid of the complexity or the involved nature of what you're proposing.
I mean, because the problem is, as we were discussing in that episode, is that with secularization, and now with COVID reinforced, we lost these rituals because the different religions were offering these ready-made rituals. And so many parts of the world, as secularization comes in, we are not engaging with these rituals because we changed our thoughts around the supernatural.
Yes.
And with that, we also lost these behaviorally relevant rituals that would help us go through the different phases of life.
Yes.
From birth to coming to age to pairing up with someone to our own children's birth and to the death of the loved ones. So maybe a version of this would work. Mm. And if you do it, please tell me how it's gone.
I will.
I'm very curious of that.
I will. And also the piece of music you proposed is really profound and lends itself to something like this. And, you know, for me, music's a very important, plays a very important role in, as far as my emotional state is concerned, it's the thing that enhances my joys and it's the thing that also mitigates my sadness. So it's a really great medium through which I can, you know, get past this this great transition.
I wonder to what extent box music is culturally relevant or irrelevant. To what extent, you know, if we were to design a ritual that is helping everybody, every human, mm-hmm. and it would have a musical element, is there any kind of music that is able to serve as that?
Yes, the answer is yes, but I think that it's different music for different people, right? Okay. I mean, I think we all respond differently to classic, in the Western classical, Indian classical, yeah. African music. And what I think would be interesting is to create a ritual like the one that you're proposing, but with music that can be customized to, or, you know, that speaks to different individuals, because what the Goldberg variations might work for me, but I know they probably wouldn't work for my sister or right. my first cousin, you know? So the question is, how do we replace that music? We keep the ritual, but replace the music with something that's more relevant or contextual for them, you know?
So do you think that the way you created this medium of MTV World where the world suddenly started to listen itself, you know, the same way we could create a 32 or some other number of these pieces of short pieces of music from pulling from all around the world, that mm-hmm. it just one. I'd love that.
That, you know. I mean, isn't that the nature of life and itself? Like, you know, the thing is, you suggested the Goldberg variation because for you it's a seminal, important, moving piece of music, then that's your context. But there are so many millions of people in the world living in so many different cultures, and not everybody would respond to that. So the reason for the why we created MTV World was to counter the idea that one culture, one piece of music should be the default for the entire world, you know? And for the longest time, Western pop music and culture were the default culture for the rest of the world, simply because, you know, it was a continuation of this imperialistic ideology that we need to impose our cultures on everybody else, as if their culture didn't matter, you know? Yeah. Of course, we're not trying to do that, because for us, the Goldberg variations is already something we share. It's a common thing to us, because you suggested it a long time ago, and I immediately bought it, and I've heard it I don't know how many times. But there is an alternative reality. So the ritual would work, I think, on what you're proposing, but we would have to customize the music. Mm.
But do you think that every culture, every part of the world, or every musical language would need to have its own music? Or would it be possible to have one set of, say, 32, where different parts of the world, people from different parts of the world, contribute to essentially I mean, it can be fusion, but, you know, because the structure of it is, you know, one and then 10 times three and then the repeat of the one.
Yes.
And so we could actually create a new variation that.
I think that there's a very interesting idea in what you're saying that should be explored by composers. There's something very powerful in it. I think there's also something powerful in creating a common way for us all to grieve and transform grief. More and more you realize that, as you were saying, the secularization of grief is a thing, right? I mean, so more and more we're finding that we are all beginning to share sorrow and rituals online through Zoom or WhatsApp or whatever might be the case, which makes me think that there's got to be a common way for us to grieve, you know? What is that ritual? I don't know. I'm not an expert on that, but there's got to be a way we can all come together and share our, you know, our sorrows within a common framework. Now, whether it be what are the musical elements of that or the food elements or the dress elements or the ritualistic elements of it, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. So do you think that this, what I suggested, would work better for you if you would choose a piece of music to go with each of those boxes?
For me, the Goldberg variations actually work really well, to be honest, because I mean, I, as a producer and a storyteller, it's perfectly designed for that. Mm. You know, so I wouldn't tinker with what you're proposing simply because I think for me, it really does work. And I wouldn't like to play a different piece of music with each of those elements. But I think for somebody else who might have had a different soundtrack to their lives and their stories and their memories are attached to other types of music, I think we would need to consider that.
Mm-hmm. I wonder whether you could make up some stories. So, you know, if you were to make up a story about your mom that somebody could have told you, yeah, that would be a really cool thing to do, yeah?
Or not. Maybe it's something that she was completely surprising, you know, about her that I could never have imagined, you know. You know, it's not all gloom and doom. I think it's just this rough transition that occurs from the day you know technically your mother is dead. She's on the other side of that wall that you so dreaded climbing. And it takes a little bit of time. And I think all of these things, the conversation, the rituals, the sharing, the, you know, the memories, they all help.
I send you a big hug.
A virtual hug.
A virtual hug. Yes.
Thank you, Tamas. This is really amazing. And I didn't think that little episode we created would one day become an episode that I would be featured in. But I'm glad we did it.
Thank you.
The Human Beast series is about understanding who we are as a species so that we can equip ourselves to take responsibility for the planet. Because if we humans are not going to do that, there's nobody else who's going to save the biosphere. If you'd like to be part of this conversation, please subscribe here now.